Okay. So this panel goes back to all the things you've heard about this morning, hopefully in your workshops too. Citizenship, forest, trees. I stole Faisal's, I told everybody I stole it from you. Social ecology. It's all connected, right? What we're talking about. So the people that we have here now to have a conversation with us are experts in their own fields, and they're going to talk to you about those areas that they care about, that they deal with every single day. Then I'm going to ask them some pointed questions about the connection between their concerns, their issues, the things that I think are the most important, and public education, and then you guys are. So we're going to try again. We've been trying with everything to make this interactive because, we're trying to move things forward to, you know, what should it be? What could it be? How can we ensure that public education lives up to its promise? So I'm going to introduce the panelists all at once. They're going to talk, each of them, for between 8 to 10 minutes, and then I'm going to ask them questions. Then we're all going to just stay at the table. I'm going to ask them questions, then you guys are going to. So on the panel we have, in alphabetical order, Craig Alexander, the first person right there. He is the Vice President, Economic Analysis at the C.D. Howe Institute. Previously, he was Senior Vice President and Chief Economist for TD Bank Group, and he has 20 years of experience in the private sector as an economic and financial forecaster. But he has also been a regular commentator on public policy and a very sought-after public speaker. Prior to joining the private sector, he spent 4 years as an economist at StatsCan, which now has their mandatory long-form census back. Yippee. And he has been a very wonderful, strong, and public advocate for the cause of literacy, and he's a champion for the charitable sector, which we like because that's us, the charitable sector. After him, we have Dr. Carolyn Bennett. To me, the most important thing that you should know about Dr. Carolyn Bennett is that she delivered my firstborn child. So she's stayed important in our lives forever. Oh, and one more thing. She is the newly appointed Minister of Indigenous and Northern Affairs. Dr. Bennett previously served as the first ever Minister of State for Public Health, and she is going to be focusing on health today, or health, during which time she established the Public Health Agency of Canada. She and her husband, Canadian film producer Peter O'Brien, have two sons. This is in her bio, and a chocolate lab named Marley. Faisal Moola, the next person, is the Director General for Ontario and Northern Canada at the David Suzuki Foundation and an adjunct professor at the University of Toronto. Faisal leads an expert team of scientists, policy experts, and community organizers at the Suzuki Foundation to support the protection of Canada's cherished wild spaces and endangered species, as well as the greening of our towns and cities. He's an avid cyclist and spends as much time as possible exploring the wonders of nature with his family. And last and totally not least is Wanda Nanibush. She is an Anishinaabe image and word warrior, curator, and community organizer. She lives on Beausoleil First Nation in her territory of Chimnising, and currently she is a guest curator at the Art Gallery of Ontario and touring her exhibition The Fifth World, which opens in January 2016 at Quag. Wanda's island life allows her to finish upcoming projects, which are hilariously many, including a film called A Love Letter to My People, a documentary on Gerald Weisnor, a book called Violence No More, and an anthology of Indigenous curatorial writing, and it says and more than that. So maybe we can ask her what the and more is. So the first person I'm going over to is Craig Alexander. Thank you, Craig.
Thanks very much. I've got a bit of a bad cold, so if I come across the voice modulating a bit, please excuse that. In terms of my 8 to 10 minutes, you know, I was asked to come and speak at this conference, and I originally thought I was going to come out with this really positive message about the impact that education is going to have in overcoming our core challenges. And then I was told that in the opening remarks, I was just to stick to the challenges. And then in the Q&A, we'll figure out part of the solution and how education fits into this. So ultimately, you're going to get a really depressing presentation by an economist, because I'm going to go through a lot of our core economic challenges. And boy, we've got a number of them. You know, when we think about how the Canadian economy is in recent years, it's not surprising that the federal election was dominated by a lot of talk about the economy. You know, which government, which party would deliver people the best outcome? Because I think there's a lot of frustration. We had a very bad recession back in 2008, 2009, and ever since the recovery got started, the pace of economic growth has not been terribly strong. At any given point in time, different parts of the country have been really, really struggling. And at the same time, a lot of the weakness has been related to the international backdrop, and that has meant that Canada has been more reliant on domestic demand to drive economic growth. And the challenge with that is that one of the byproducts of it is that we have a major imbalance. Consumers have now taken on way too much debt. This is a reflection of low interest rates and the fact that income hasn't been rising that strongly. And so if you want to maintain a certain standard of living and your income isn't rising, and interest rates are low, well, one of the solutions is you debt finance. But there's limits to how long this can go on, and as a consequence, there's a lot of need for Canada to rotate its sources or its drivers of economic growth from domestic demand towards exports and investment. And this is something the Bank of Canada has been championing for some time, arguing that we were going to see this rotation. Well, one of the challenges we have is that on the export side, one of our biggest export sector is the resource sector, and there has been an enormous collapse in commodity prices, particularly for energy. It wasn't that long ago that we were talking about a commodity super cycle. You know, we were talking about commodity prices booming on the back of really strong global demand. Well, what actually happened was it turned out that the rosy global story really deteriorated quite quickly. If you think back and you think about the pace of global economic growth, in a recession, you normally see the world economy grow at about 2%, so it doesn't contract. And this is why the 2008-2009 experience was so bad. It was probably the first time since the 1930s we'd actually seen the world economy outright contract. So this was terrible. But then when the recovery started, the advanced economies were really struggling outside of Canada. Europe was having issues. The United States was slow to get on its feet. But at the same time, what was really supporting global growth was booming demand in the emerging markets, and it was creating a lot of demand for our raw materials like metals and nickel, zinc, aluminum, but also energy like oil. And you might remember we used to talk about the BRICS. You know, these were the golden children of the world economy, and BRICS stood for an acronym. It was Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Okay, so who are the problem children today? Oh, right. Brazil, Russia, it's not actually fair to say India, but China and South Africa. Korean emerging markets has really deteriorated because it shows that there was a lot of imbalances that had developed in these economies and they couldn't continue the growth they were having. So this has created a real challenge for the Canadian economy. Like here in Ontario, we don't feel it quite as badly because the Ontario economy is growing at north of 2%. But if you're out in Alberta, it's a recession. If you're in Newfoundland, it's a recession. A lot of the commodity-rich provinces are really struggling. And Canada in recent years has been trying to diversify its trade, trying to, you know, leverage more of the world economy because we are very tied to the U.S. And when we look at the U.S. economy, it's actually the bright spot right now. And there's a lot of hope that if the U.S. continues to do well, that this will lift the Canadian economy. But one of the fundamental questions you have to ask yourself is can Canada compete in the United States? Because what we've been seeing is Canada has had a declining market share in the U.S. economy. If you actually look at our businesses relative to the U.S., from a competitiveness point of view, Canadian businesses are only about 72% as competitive as their U.S. counterparts. So if you want to understand why the Canadian dollar is down near 65 cents, this is the exchange rate we actually need to be able to compete. So Canada has a competitiveness challenge. So there's an issue about weak global demand, but there's a question about how do we compete? And because the world economy is so weak, we continue to have extraordinarily low interest rates, which shockingly people actually think are normal. You know, I do real estate presentations across this country, and you know, one of the things I've realized is that young people actually think these interest rates are normal. I remember an event where I met a fella and he said, you know, that his five-year mortgage had just come up for renewal. He bought his first house 5 years ago. His mortgage was up for renewal, and so he was asking me the typical question, you know, should he go fixed or should he go variable? And he said, you know, in my experience, interest rates only go down. And I thought, you're absolutely right. But if we think about Thanksgiving, the experience of all the turkeys was you only get fed. And so we have a challenge that our economy has become dependent on extraordinarily low interest rates, which are actually creating their own set of imbalances. So I do believe Canada's housing market is overbuilt and overvalued. And this actually creates significant risks going forward. But at the same time, beyond these cyclical factors, there's structural problems or structural challenges we face. The two big ones are the interaction of globalization and technical change that are revolutionizing the global economy and having extraordinarily far-reaching effects. And it's not just one, it's the interconnectivity of the two. You can now produce anywhere you want in the world at the lowest price. Right? You can do your research and development in one country, and you can build it someplace else, and you can ship it someplace else, and increasingly we're doing it with services. And at the same time, workers are actually now competing more with machines. The capital can actually do a lot more. And so we have a situation where the Canadian economy is getting shaped by this. We can see a declining share of the economy is traditional manufacturing, an increasing share is services. And what we're seeing within the sectors is a push towards more sophisticated production, because if you try to compete with places like China on labor costs, you will lose. People talk about the introduction of disruptive technologies. You know, the reality is we've always had disruptive technologies. Every technological revolution has been disruptive to somebody. But a good example was, you know, if we went back to the turn of the century in North America, we were building canals because people thought canals was how we're going to ship products. And then along came the railroad and put the canals out of business. This was a disruptive technology. But what's really changed is the speed at which the disruption occurs. Because now, within a short period of time, you can suddenly find that your business model is completely redundant. So, you know, the big fear that banks have is that they're going to wake up one day and find out they're Kodak. And ultimately, technology has moved in a way that makes them redundant relative to other financial services that are being provided through cyber technology. So there's dramatic changes happening from an economic point of view, and this has big, far-reaching impacts from an economic and socioeconomic perspective. So in recent years, all of the job creation in Canada has been for high-skilled workers. Right? High-skilled workers are in enormous demand in a globalized, technologically revolutionized labor market. You know, what's not in demand is middle-skill workers. You know, we haven't figured out how to outsource low-skill activities, but a lot of middle-skill jobs are being outsourced and seeing a lot of pressure in terms of middle-skill occupations. And this is having a byproduct in terms of raising income inequality around the world, including here in Canada. Now, I actually think there's a lot of confusion about the income inequality story because I think we're importing a lot of the story from the United States. In the U.S., income inequality has skyrocketed, social mobility has collapsed. If you want an idea how bad things are going, if America doesn't change track in the next few years, the level of social mobility in the U.S. is going to be equivalent to Victorian England. You think about all the stories like shows like Upstairs, Downstairs, Downton Abbey, and things like that, right? Nobody does class better than the Brits, right? But that's where America is heading, given what's happened to income inequality in America. In Canada, we import a lot of the story. In actual fact, the situation in Canada isn't as dire as the U.S. So, for example, income inequality in Canada is currently sitting on the average of all the advanced economies. So this is not terribly high. But there are issues that it is rising. And the other dimension is that what we can see is that ultimately in the United States, is their economies become more productive, but all the income is going to capital. None of it's going to labor. In Canada, what you can see is there was a divide between the division of income, between capital and labor in the 1980s and 90s. But since the mid-90s, productivity has been driving income higher. The problem is that from an economic point of view, your economy only grows for one of two reasons. Number one, you either have more workers, or number two, you use those workers more productively. Well, here's the problem with demographics, right? The population is getting older. We have fewer workers entering the labor force. Labor force growth is slow, and no amount of immigration is going to solve this. You would have, you know, right now we're bringing about 250,000 immigrants each year. In order to offset the aging of the baby boomers, you'd have to bring in 2 million a year. There's no way we could absorb this. So our economy is not going to grow from a labor force point of view. So where are we going to grow? And the answer is we have to do it through productivity. But we have a productivity problem. Canada is not competitive. So let's say do the static exercise. What happens if we don't change course? Right? The answer is that the pace of economic growth in Canada is going to slow. It's going to slow dramatically, particularly in some regions. Like Atlantic Canada, where the population aging effect is greatest, their long-term trend rate of growth is close to zero going forward. Right? For Canada, the pace of economic growth is going to slow to around 1.5%. So, from an economic challenge point of view, and yes, I know I'm out of time, you can save your arm. This is the last slide. There's two paths ahead in my mind, right? Path one is we have slow economic growth with weak rising living standards. We have fierce competition over the division of that income pie that isn't growing, and that creates big challenges in terms of funding our social priorities. Or number two, we change course and we focus on creating a more competitive, more innovative economy so the income pie gets better, bigger, and that gives us the ability to actually meet our fiscal commitments on core priorities. The challenge, though, is that I don't think there's a strong awareness of this from the point of view of the general public, and governments don't lead, they follow. So lots of provocative things to talk about in the Q&A. Thank you.
Great to be here. Thank you, Annie, as always. And some think that my success in the election is the 2,000 babies that I delivered who all are 18 this year. So it is great to gather here on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of New Credit. And First Peoples have a lot to teach us about health versus health care. And I think that was my first comeuppance as the minister, what I lovingly referred to as the Minister of Handwashing, but it was the first and last Minister of State for Public Health, where I think after SARS we figured out that this health care thing wasn't going to fix things, because we had no idea how it was transmitted, the incubation, we had no treatment, and all of a sudden we in the Western world had to say, how do we make sure we don't get it? And I think that in infectious disease, and I remember when Prime Minister Martin called and asked me for the job, I said, but you know, it can't just be about infectious disease. It has to be about preventing all the chronic diseases and blah, 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 blah. I thought, well, I'm not even in cabinet yet, but I have already sort of trying to rewrite my mandate letter. But what happened during that time, and I think you will all leave deputized, that I never want you to say health when you mean health care or health care when you mean health. We want more health, and we'd all rather need less health care for ourselves and our families. And so it is, again, about us deciding that it is the medicine wheel, not the medical model. That we want actually to keep people well, not just patch them up when they get sick. And that actually was Tommy Douglas's, you know, other goal of Medicare. It wasn't just the solidarity. It was that we needed systems for health. And that's I think, what we're trying to do, and why health-promoting schools and all of the things that we know can be part of the solutions that I'm not allowed to talk about. So when I became minister, I had somehow understood that there were these two feuding factions. There were the, if people would just eat nicely, exercise, not drink, not gamble, you know, that they would be fine. Stop smoking, for heaven's sakes. And then there was the other people, the Dennis Raphael, the people who said it's poverty stupid. It's the social determinants of health. And so one day on a boarding pass, I said, well, can't we get this together in terms of what if the root system were the social determinants of poverty, violence, the environment, shelter, equity, education? And what if in the tree trunks were the choices that you make on all of these things around smoking, drinking, sexual health, all of those things, and exercise? And then the ultimate outcomes would be the branches that is really the report card for a society. What is the health equity, health inequity? How do we keep a population as healthy as they can be, leaving no one behind? If we measure the health inequities, then we start to be able to understand whether we are having a sort of after the fact running the repair shop health care system, or whether we're actually creating systems for health. And so I thought that, you know, I had a lovely little apple tree that medical officers of health said, Carolyn, we don't want the leaves to fall off every fall. So I changed it to my beloved Georgian Bay White Pine, because the west wind shapes the pine and therefore there are no branches on the west side. And so I decided we'd put cancer and kidney disease and diabetes on the other side where there's no branch to hold it, and that we would move to the healthy outcomes on the other side. Bill Mussel from the Native Mental Health Association started to like the tree. This tree evolved over the 2 years I was minister. Every group I came to came up at the end to give me advice for my tree. But the one that really mattered to me was Bill Mussel said, your tree has no ground. And so I had to draw in the ground there. And the ground was a personal cultural identity. It is your self-esteem. It's your resilience. It's the sense of control you have over your own life, that you feel like a proud Métis woman. And sometimes that only takes one teacher, one camp counselor, one whatever who believes in you to actually have you back on track, regardless of the poverty, violence, the environment, shelter, equity, all of those things that were pretty shitty at the beginning. And so it is, I think, really important as we go forward, we look at that all of what we can learn from this and how many things we can tick off. We then took this out to a Health Goals for Canada exercise, and out of the 9 health goals, only half of one of them was health care. The rest was health. But that's not the way we organize a health department. It's not the way we organize the resources in health. That the surgeon stamping his feet at the CEO of the hospital that people will die if I don't get a new gamma knife is the way we actually assign resources. It's not for the public health nurse in the school. And so I think that what I'm hoping that we can look at is some of the things that we were also not really, didn't have policy levers for. The issue of parenting, the issue of sense of belonging, that those were the two things that came up at every roundtable we did on the Health Goals for Canada, and we still don't really know what to do about it. Except when you see a kid in trouble who says the first time that I ever felt I belonged was when I joined a gang. The first time that I ever was told I was good at anything was shoplifting. That you actually realize that when arts and culture and sports and all of those things came out of schools, that actually these kids actually had to find other talents that would have been harvested in a full system. So I guess I think that, you know, from food policy and understanding food and where food comes from, in terms of how nutrition becomes part of that, how physical literacy becomes part of that. I once got into trouble as minister by yet another kid had drowned in the summer, and I said, why can't all kids in Canada know how to swim? As the former you know, medical advisor to the Royal Life Saving Society. I mean, we can set some goals for these things that really are about health outcomes. You know, most drownings are preventable. That we actually have to say, if we're going to measure our society by these preventable things, like suicide, like you know, that which comes from bullying and all the other things that I know that you're dealing with all the time. I remember being in southern Sudan, and we met with the minister, deputy minister of education, and public health, and I thought, well, why couldn't every kid who finishes high school be put on a bicycle and go out and be a health promoter? Like, why can't we equip people by the end that they know everything there is to know to be able to keep their communities healthy and safe? And so I guess I will leave it there, except to say that in the demographic challenges facing us, that when you look at function and age and how the WHA looks at how we have to have people aging above the disability threshold. And that means that we actually have to start earlier in terms of healthy weights for kids and the kinds of things that actually mean they won't get diabetes, they won't end up with kidney problems, they won't end up with all of those things. And I guess the last is that how it flips the other way. The number of places I've been across Canada where the school is closed because everybody's sick. And that when you have 12 people living in one house with no running water, that you cannot be surprised that infectious disease and all of these things, to say, let alone how on earth they would do their homework, that we actually have to look at all of the social determinants if we're going to get this right. Thanks very much.
Good afternoon. It's an honor to have an opportunity to speak with you. My name is Faisal. I work for the David Suzuki Foundation. I work primarily as a scientist at the foundation, but I'm really going to tell a story about my friends and allies in northeastern British Columbia, in Denizah territory, Treaty 8 territory, because it's a very interesting story about the way in which we are unsustainably managing our environment here in Canada. Now, several years ago, there was a science study that came out. It was published in a very well-known journal. It was called Science. And it showed that very few places on our planet have not yet been touched by modern humans. From Arctic tundra to primeval rainforest to arid desert, our natural world has been fragmented by ever-expanding towns and cities, crisscrossed with roads and transmission lines and pipelines, and pockmarked by pump jacks, flare stacks, and other infrastructure used to drill, frack, and strip mine fossil fuels from the ground. The need to supply food, fiber, shelter, fresh water for more than 7 billion of us that now live on the planet is driving the wholesale conversion of forests and wetlands and grasslands and other ecosystems. Indeed, satellite images taken hundreds of kilometers above the surface of the planet reveal an Earth that we have changed irrevocably in a very short period of time. Now, the significance of modern human land use was brought into sharp relief recently as a consequence of a series of remarkable maps that were published in the Atlantic Monthly by a researcher by the name of Dr. Timothy Golden at the University of Maryland Center for International and Security Studies. Now, what Timothy did was he used data that normally you would have acquired for military purposes to essentially get a picture of the range of human land use across the planet. The bright spots that you see on the image above me reflect sources of light emissions at night. Lit homes, powered factories, illuminated city streets, and the largely urban infrastructure which now dominates most of our continent. Golden's maps show that our planet is now under the direct influence of the human footprint, largely due to urbanization, but also the sprawling growth of energy infrastructure and development in formerly intact areas like the Northern Boreal Forest. Now, although industrial projects like the proposed Northern Gateway Pipeline in my home province of British Columbia or the defeated mega quarry here in southern Ontario, they typically grab the headlines and they bring out public opposition. but it's often the combined contribution of a range of human activities all happening on the same land base that actually drives nature beyond critical tipping points. Once these critical tipping points are passed, rapid ecological changes can happen, such as species extinction. For example, in British Columbia's Peace Region, the home of the Denizha people, forestry, energy, mineral leases and licenses are widespread and multi-layered across their entire territory. As various large industries have exploited these tenures, a sprawling network of large clearcuts, oil wells, dams and reservoirs, fracking operations, and thousands of seismic lines, roads and pipelines have now come to dominate the landscape. The David Suzuki Foundation and our partners, the Denizha peoples of Treaty 8, recently published the first ever spatial analysis of industrial land use that has occurred over 56,000 square kilometers of the Peace Region of northeastern BC. This is sort of illustrative of a situation that's happening right across Canada. Again, these are the traditional territories of the Denizha people, but what I'm going to talk about is very symptomatic across Indigenous territories from coast to coast to coast. Within Denizha territory, we found that there are over 16,000 oil and gas well sites and 8,000 petroleum and natural gas facilities. There are 45,000 kilometers of roads, 1,163 kilometers of transmission lines, 28,000 kilometers of oil and gas pipelines. Three-quarters of these pipelines are still in operation. In fact, if you placed all of the pipelines, the roads, the seismic lines that occur within Denizha territory, and you put them end to end, they would actually wrap around the surface of the planet an astounding 4.5 times. And this is happening in just one Indigenous nation's territory. When you add up all of the development, the aggregate human footprint in Denizha territories, it's outstanding. Today, more than 65% of their traditional territories has felt the impact of some sort of industrial development. This is leaving little intact habitat for sensitive endangered species such as caribou to feed, breed, and roam. Scientists like my colleagues now believe that caribou, for example, in the region are no longer self-sustaining and are spiraling towards extinction. Now, here's the rub. The Denizha people have relied upon caribou as their primary source of food for thousands of years, but they can no longer hunt them. This is a clear violation of not just their treaty rights, but their Aboriginal rights, which are enshrined in the Canadian Constitution. And we have to remember that this situation didn't happen because of accident or because of a laissez-faire attitude when it comes to resource and land management in Canada. Numerous industries in the area are operating perfectly legally and according to the rules and regulations set by the provincial and the federal government. But legal experts believe that a root cause of the problem is that our resource laws, our environmental laws, are in fact hardwired to fail communities and the environment in Canada. The narrow focus of those laws enable industries to operate in isolation from one another. And British Columbia, like most jurisdictions, lacks a legal framework to proactively and comprehensively manage the aggregate footprint of all sources of human impacts operating within the same area. Because of this fact, the Denizha, with their partners, such as the David Suzuki Foundation, are now in discussions with the provincial government of British Columbia to radically overhaul the way in which we currently oversee and regulate cumulative impacts of industrial land use in their territories, ranging from declining water quality that may arise from multiple industries using a common resource to new emerging threats such as climate change. If successful, a cumulative, Indigenous-driven approach to governing resource development would upend the current management paradigm. It would focus on the management needs of the land, the water, the air, the wildlife, and the Indigenous communities that depend on them first, before the resources that we decide to extract. In practical terms, it would mean that rather than focusing on what we should take from nature to create wealth and employment, we should first consider what needs to be retained in nature to sustain both wildlife and the well-being of local communities: clean air, safe drinking water, and healthy food to eat. At a recent symposium with First Nations in northern British Columbia, numerous leaders, from elected leaders to Indigenous elders to youth, talked about the fact that in order to manage the cumulative consequences of development that they're facing in their territories, it'll require new institutions, new forms of governance, perhaps new laws, Indigenous laws. More importantly, it will mean that our governments need to act more proactive in a holistic way when we think about the world. One that recognizes that far from just being a place to extract resources like fossil fuels, timber, and minerals, nature is our home. Nature provides our most fundamental needs, and nature dictates limits to growth. And so its protection must be our highest priority. Furthermore, managing this massive human footprint around the planet requires leadership, much of which, I'll say most of which, is emerging from the Indigenous who are on the front line of the day-to-day realities of cumulative environmental change. In 2010, Dunizag community members from northern BC traveled to Victoria, the home of the British Columbia government, to demand that cumulative impacts must be addressed before any new industrial development is allowed to proceed within their territories. Speaking to reporters, Liz Logan, who's the tribal chief, said in the reference to the massive amount of development in their territories, "We've become the cash register for the province. Now our way of life is going to be interfered with again. We are bush people. The land is our grocery store, our pharmacy, our school, and our church. It still sustains us." Our Dinizah partners are in federal court right now, arguing that industrialization of their lands is an infringement on both their treaty and their Aboriginal rights, because they can no longer hunt, fish, gather medicinal plants, and participate in a sustained and meaningful way in the traditional activities that their communities have done for thousands and thousands of years prior to European settlement. I have no doubt that the Dinizah and Indigenous peoples who are fighting similar court battles are going to win. So here's the challenge for all of us that want to foster reconciliation with our Indigenous partners. If true reconciliation is going to continue, it must mean that we have to abandon antiquated models of resource development that drive economic growth in our communities. We need to protect nature. Most important, we need to honour our obligations to Canada's First Nations, Inuit and Métis, and we have to regulate and reform cumulative impacts to make sure that we protect the very things that are the life support systems of our communities. Thank you.
And don't start my time yet. All right, have a seat. When you go last, I find it's good to get you to stand up so that you can actually focus on what I'm going to say. I want to start by acknowledging the territory that we're on, the Mississauga Anishinaabe, as well as the displaced nations of the Seneca and the Huron, and the exterminated Neutrals, Peyton, and the Erie. And also I want to acknowledge Canada as Indigenous land all the way from coast to coast, which we share with all the nations that have come here. I'm Wanda Nanibush, Anishinaabe Kwe. My name actually, the whole name means wandering trickster, so I'm not sure if you should trust what I'm going to say. I felt like today I wanted to be a little more radical, which means to get at the root of things. So I'll be saying, giving ideas that are possibly hard to accomplish, but I think we actually do have the power and the resources to do it. As I was having coffee, I'm a bit of a nerd, so I love names and anachronisms. So for today, it is clue. So we're going to clue in today. We're going to have a clue, which is CLLWW. Which is children, land, language, water, and women. For me, this is what Idle No More was about, and what I and so many others continue to work on. The image of the round dance really stays with me as an image of unity, when we actually could do something together I think dance, in a way, can change the world, like it did in South Africa, actually. Dances can bring down entire regimes, and I think it's something that we forget all the time. So I think we were reminded of that during Idle No More. For me, the movement was really driven by youth and by women. And the women, I think it's writing an imbalance. So the institutionalization of patriarchy within this kind of Indian Act system, within the system of Canadian governance, that balance needed to be righted. There's a prophecy about that. And so the women came out. And part of the women coming out is also about reshifting the priorities away from negotiations with the government under very strict rules that are already set in place to thinking about children, water, communities, like these kinds of groundwork that women have been doing for so long. And they have knowledge of these things. And for the youth, we finally have a generation, and I can't say an entire generation, but we finally have a generation that may not have as much shame as the previous generations and may not fear the government as much as previous generations. And so their power and their strength was there. And I met this one young guy, this is another part of it, I think, who had been struggling with what we call the fast life, you know, drugs and alcohol. For a long time, going to treatment, coming out of treatment. And then the very first, he'd just come out of treatment and he went to a Idle No More rally. And the drum group invited him to sit down at the drum. And he said as soon as he sat at that drum and he sang, he's just never, ever looked back. He's never, ever, he stepped straight out of the fast life, and all because he wanted to look after his daughter and raise her in a different way than maybe he had been raised. So children are the center of the Anishinaabe community. We act and think in ways that protect them for many generations by protecting the world that they will inherit. We also nurture their self-worth, curiosity, individuality. They are assisted in finding their gifts and are obligated to find a path to sharing those gifts. They are also wise because, like elders, they're the closest to the spirit world, so they have less blocks to their imagination, and they are also closest to the fundamental creative force of the universe. We are born with thought, emotion, body knowledge, and together their health feeds our spirit, and vice versa, our spirit feeds them. This country's history has robbed us of our children through residential schools and now through child welfare. Not now, it's been going on since the 60s. And I'm a product of that. My mother went to residential school and I went into foster care. I'm the youngest of 19 kids. Most of us went in and out of foster care for our lives. And there are more kids in care today than there were at the height of the Indian residential school. When it was mandatory attendance. I can tell you for a fact that racism and not understanding the legacy of the Indian residential schools, or what I call the colonial stress disorder that we all have, and the utter lack of preventative services or services to help parents become better parents before removing their children, all of that has come into play. And it's interesting because I made a little film about this, but I met the cop who took me away when I was five. When I was sitting in a classroom, I was in a new foster home, so I was in another city. And I'm sitting there and I was like, I just felt like I knew this guy somehow. And so he comes over and he gives me his card and he's like, I'm the cop who took you away from your family. If you want to talk, give me a call. So it took me about a month, but I did call him. And we had a little chat, and what struck me, I wasn't surprised by it, is his undeniable sense of his own rightness. And I think that happens also in child welfare. We have a kind of racist, classist understanding of what a good family is and what all that entails in that. And I think we can't even see our own classism and racism when we make these decisions to remove children. And speaking of that, We fought very hard to have control over our children. We're still fighting for control over our children. So 1985 comes along, and finally there is a new kind of law where we have to be with Native parents. So we got that much. So I got to be returned to my reserve after being away for 5 years. And I can't describe the necessity of needing access to land, language, and your people. Sorry. Okay, and then there's poverty. It's often the reason that kids are taken away in Native communities. And poverty is part of the decision for deciding about bad situations. And this comes from, it's an institutionalized thing for us. The price of Canada's wealth has been at the expense of our land, our bodies, our people, our mother, the earth, and our potential. So I was just wanting to talk about this story of when I went up in northern Manitoba recently. I'm trying to define the difference between land-based people and, say, like the urban community, or we have so many different communities. So we went traveling around in the hydro-affected communities in northern Manitoba, their Cree communities. And since they've been dealing with hydro since the 70s, it's a good place to learn about what happens to people, how poverty is something that is systematically enacted by our policies. It's not something that's innate in being Native. So I was sitting in a gym, and there was like a community thing going on. Kids are dancing, and I didn't want to sit with our group, because when you do that, nobody wants to talk to you. So I just went and sat next to this elderly lady. And so she's like, oh, why are you here? And I said, I'm here to talk to the hunters and trappers and about what's happened with hydro. And she's like, you know, that's my granddaughter over there, and she'll never see the land that I grew up on. She can't swim in this water. She can't fish in these rivers. She'll never see a beach. And that really struck me. Their area, actually, everybody had a healthy income from the fishery, and hydro totally destroyed that. And then you get 90% of people on welfare. That is not what they wanted. That's not what they asked for. But it sure helps the Canadian economy. So who's on welfare here? Is it us or is it you? The other part of this equation is the adequate... 0 minutes, yeah, right. Is the adequate resourcing. So when we do want control over healthcare, when we want control over child welfare, education, the amount of resources that are put into that is a recipe for failure. So then, and that failure is then blamed on us. And also the rules are the same as the Canadian rules. So then why the hell are we doing it ourselves? Doesn't make sense. So those are some of the things. I'll say one thing about, I want to get to land. I'm going to say, get rid of the doctrine of discovery. Get rid of terra nullius as the basis for Canadian sovereignty over Indigenous people. Treaties are the true basis of why and how Canada came to be, how Indigenous peoples decided to deal with Europeans in peace, friendship, trust, sharing, mutual responsibility, and in many ways, non-interference. Instead, we have Section 9124 of the Constitution Act of 1867, and from that, the Indian Act. This is unilateral legislation of every aspect of our existence. It gives Canada legislative authority over Indians and lands reserved for Indians. This is why we have the Indian Act in a culture of abuse. And the facade of protection, because it's really paternalism. Get rid of that section. We can govern ourselves. We are not in the same place as we were in 1969 with the White Paper. Getting rid of the Indian Act doesn't have to mean assimilation. It can be self-determination if we take treaties seriously. And an Aboriginal title. So if we just assume that Native people have title to their lands, which is ridiculous that we have to say this, if you just accept that, then the onus is on the government to limit that, to prove why it's limiting that. And then we don't have to go into Canadian courts and do all this fighting, you know, as a complete frickin' underdog. It's actually the government's responsibility to prove why it's going to limit our rights and all the rights that stem from that. So I have a lot more to say, but I'm going to stop there.
Okay. Yay. Well, there's obviously a lot to talk about. And I want you to remember again why we're hearing about this. And I was going to ask everybody the same question, but I think nobody is a sort of shrinking violet who won't be able to take up the time to talk. We're going to try and take less than 15 minutes so that you can ask questions. I think, in a way, Craig, at one point you talked about government doesn't lead. It really is pushed by the public, and you said the public has a weak awareness of the challenge. You were talking about the economy, but actually I think probably seems to hold true with what everybody said. So I'm going to start with you, Craig. Now you can talk about education. Yep. You talked about very, very specific challenges in terms of the gap, which, yes, is not as big in Canada as it is in the United States, in terms particularly of the growth in jobs, in terms of the high-skilled jobs, not the medium-skilled ones, and you talked about innovation. So I guess my question to you, in terms of that, public having a weak awareness and what we need to do then in our schools, if you were thinking about public education and you were going, okay, here are, let's give you the top three things, what do we need our graduates to be equipped with? What kind of do we need to shift in terms of how we think of the purpose of public education? What's going to, you did present a very depressing picture. What can we do in our public education systems that will make a difference to that?
Okay, so let's start off with the basics, that education is the great enabler, right? This is the foundation upon which you build all your skills. And where we are headed from an economic point of view is that we are going to need an ever more skilled workforce that's capable of changing with the times. The reality is we actually can't stop globalization or technical change. You could try to resist it if you want, but it's going to end up being a very futile exercise. So it's about adapting and overcoming. And to me, what that means is we desperately need to get the most skilled workforce we possibly can. Now, one of my sources of frustration is that there's also been a shift from an economic point of view in terms of the willingness or desire on the part of businesses to do training. You often hear businesses complaining that the education system is not producing work-ready employees. Well, to me, there's a little bit of scapegoating going on here because, you know, if we look at the post-secondary education system, it actually wasn't designed to create work-ready employees. You know, the college system is more aligned that way because of the nature of the programs, but the university system wasn't ever designed that way. And if we actually look at the dollars being spent on training by businesses, adjusted for inflation, it's actually been falling for the last 10 years. So on the one hand, we need more skilled workforce. On the other hand, businesses aren't doing the training, and they're putting the emphasis on the education system to actually deliver. So first of all, I think there should be a push in terms of getting businesses to actually accept the fact that they need to do more training. But on the other hand, we also have to recognize that weakness is going to be there. So we need the education system to deliver the maximum skilled employee that we can possibly do. And on this front, there's signs we can do better, right? If we look at literacy scores for Canadian adults, it's pretty shocking to find 5 in 10 don't have the necessary literacy to succeed in a modern knowledge-based economy. 6 in 10 don't have the desired level of numeracy. These are shocking results. When I first started doing work on the literacy front, I couldn't believe that Canada could have a problem on something so basic as literacy and numeracy, and we do. With respect to kids in the primary education system, you know, our students do pretty well, but there's signs of weaknesses there as well. So, for example, math scores are declining at a time when math scores actually are more important. I do think we could do a better job in educating our youth in terms of preparing them for post-secondary education so they have better understanding of what their outcome might look like on the other side of the programs they take. Because I could put up a slide that shows you employment rates by education, right? And what do you get at the top? Well, you get engineering and you get science and so on, right? And then at the bottom, you get liberal arts. And then you go and you do the next chart of enrollment rates. And you know what? It's almost a mirror image. Now, I'm not saying that kids shouldn't study liberal arts. I'm actually hugely in favor of liberal arts, and I think that the skills they give you are deeply understated. In fact, most of the, within the financial services community where I came from, most of the people that failed, it wasn't because they didn't have the technical skills, it was because they actually didn't have the soft skills to advance. So in actual fact, I'm a strong advocate of all forms of education, but a lot of our students are making uninformed decisions around which programs they go into, and then they're shocked when they get to the other side and suddenly find out that their skills aren't in demand.
I'm going to interrupt you for 1 second. So in your last 30 seconds, what you said you did want to talk about how important the investment was in education. So looking at the state of our economy and the growth and everything else, is it still important that we put more money? This is a ridiculously rhetorical question, but anyway. How do we balance that? Right now we have governments going, we have to cut back, we have to spend less. How do we as advocates...
Well, we need the resources, but we also need to ensure the resources that are currently present are being optimized. And so the answer is probably a bit of a balancing act amongst both. Now, very quickly on income inequality, because we need to get on to other people, but on income inequality, I think part of the discussion we're having around the 1% and the 99% is actually unconstructive for the simple reason that if you took 80% of the income from the 1%, gave it to the 99, you actually wouldn't move the needle on income inequality because there's so few people in the 1%. Now, should we have a progressive tax system? Absolutely. Right? So I'm in favor of a progressive tax system. This isn't to say that we shouldn't have that. What I'm saying is to focus on that actually leads you to a policy recommendation that actually won't achieve the goal. If you want to deal with income inequality, I actually think the way you deal with it is removing barriers to opportunity for people that are lower down on the income scale and people that are having that are facing disadvantages. So I told you we're going to have labor shortages. I told you we're going to have slowing labor force participation. We have an Aboriginal community that's being underdeveloped and under-accessed, which if we actually end up with better outcomes for Aboriginals, we'd actually end up with a stronger economy and you'd reduce income inequality. If you had immigration policies that helped immigrants better integrate into the Canadian economy, you'd end up with better outcomes for immigrants and you'd deal with income inequality. If you help youth get better outcomes through things like better skills through the education system, you remove the barriers and you match them better in the labor market, they're going to have better outcomes and you're going to reduce income inequality. So ultimately, I think that really the focus should be on reducing the barriers to opportunity. And if we focus on that, we can actually move the needle in a more effective way. And I do think education is part of that.
Okay, and that really goes to Carolyn's ground of your tree. You know, in the same way you talked about what we have to look at is the ground. I can't remember the things that were in that ground, but they had to do with a sense of agency, self-esteem, identity. So if we think again, we've got a public education system here. We are all concerned about ensuring that we've set broad enough goals for our system that we, despite the fact that math is very important, that we don't narrow the definition of education. We ensure that we are building the people that we need for this next generation. And in terms of their health, then, if you were going to look at that ground, what do we need to be doing differently in our schools, or what are the kind of capacities that graduates need in order to ensure that they're not on the bad side of the tree, they're on where all the bad stuff was, they're on the good side of the tree?
Well, I think that the ground is hugely important, and so that's why language and culture and all of those things are hugely important in making healthy choices, we as a society have to make the healthy choices, the easy choices, but I think that it is about health literacy and civic efficacy. And I think that the school system can help with actually making sure, and I don't know if there's metrics on health literacy, but the idea of knowing what's good for you, what's bad for you, what works, what doesn't work, how you read a paper and find out that this was only 12 people funded by a drug company. How do you determine what you read in the paper and how you apply it to your own life? And then civic efficacy. So in 2000, when I wrote how Canadians can remake their healthcare system and killer cure, the issue in the front was that to Canadians as empowered patients, effective advocates,
and engage citizens. And I think the education system is supposed to be, that's what post-secondary was about creating citizens and knowing how the system works and know how you get the system and the rules changed. And so I just would put those two things as the health literacy and civic efficacy, and then you're done.
Fantastic. And that's it's great because it goes, you guys weren't here in the morning, but we had a very impassioned Alan Sears from the University of New Brunswick talking about citizenship education, what that really means. One of the best things he said was that there shouldn't, that citizenship awards in schools should be banned because they're for the people who sit down, shut up, and be good. And to him, that's not what a good citizen is. They're people who are empowered, who are effective advocates, and who are engaged. So thank you very much. So, you know, on to the depressing story. So, Faisal, you said a lot of things, but you also said that the current system that we have in terms of our, you know, the way we extract resources, how we deal with resources, how we deal with our whole, you know, earth is unsustainable. So then, if that is unsustainable, and we are the people who drive that unsustainability in a way because of what we want. I want to have electricity. I want to be able to watch whatever I can want on TV. I want to be able to buy stuff. I am, you know, I'm just as bad as everybody else. I hope you're all bad too. But if this is unsustainable, and if we are the drivers, back to Craig's point about, you know, it's either the lack of knowledge of the public or the public is what drives government, what do we have to change in the way we educate young people in terms of maybe educating different kinds of people who have a different kinds of sense that, or I don't know, become different in a way that they are not the people driving this unsustainable force. I hope that makes sense.
Okay, there's a lot in that. There's no question that the consumption problem is real, and I'm not going to talk about that. I think there's actually two drivers. One is that Canadians don't understand our obligations to Indigenous people. And I am a very strong proponent of something that Pam Palmatier, who's a researcher, Indigenous researcher at Ryerson University, who said is that Indigenous people are the best and last hope for the planet. And I'll tell you why I believe that. It's largely because of the fact that they have rights that are enshrined in treaties and also in the Canadian Constitution around being able to continue to do the things that a sustainable society does. When it comes to harvesting fish or meat or berries or plants and such. The ability for people like Wanda to continue to exercise her treaty and Indigenous rights is totally predicated on an environment that still produces fish and animals and clean water and clean air and such. So it completely changes the framing around how we actually have to look at the land and how we treat the land. It's a much stronger recognition that, misquote one of the corporations that has its name on this building, let me ask you, you can guess this, they have a tagline that says, we're richer than you think, or you're richer than you think, right? The first time I saw that, I was absolutely pissed off because I'm still paying off my student loan, and it's now 30 years. But they're actually totally right. We're loaded. But the problem is that our true wealth is actually not found in our pocketbooks and our corporate bank sheets and our government coffers. The true wealth of this country is found in the land and the waters and the communities that it sustains. From a practical perspective, for you as educators, I would say that you need to help children fall in love with nature. Because they're not going to fight for something unless they experience it, unless they fall in love with it, and then they're much more likely to find interests in the science or the art or whatever aspect associated with sustainability. So it's a long-winded answer, but I hope it addressed
it. It's a pretty great answer, actually. No, it's good. And it has kind of a solution in it. Okay, Wanda,
again. I'm ready.
You're ready? You're just ready already? Okay, go, Wanda.
No,
do you want me to ask you a question?
Ask me some. well, your job's not over.
I know. It's like, Never mind. So I think that, you know, I particularly love that dances can bring down entire regimes. I think, again, back to this, you know, Carolyn's Earth, and that people don't know enough, that we're still the public that has weak awareness of the challenges. My question to you is twofold, and I'm actually going to cheat and tell a story here. Because I had an epiphany a few years ago, which some people have already heard this story, where I was at a conference in Ottawa. There was a young man talking, and he was from up north, and he had made a film, and on the bottom of the trailer of the film, it said, "What if our history wasn't written down?" And in that moment, I realized that I didn't think of him as having real history because of the way I was educated. And I was incredibly shocked and ashamed. But I knew it to be true. I knew deep in myself that I suddenly went, oh, I'm the problem. Wanda, you're not the problem. It's me. So that was my first revelation, and it was really awful. But I'm so old that I did get taught Jacques Cartier Discovered Canada. I lived in Labrador. There was no attention paid to, anyway. So we know two things. 90% of kids go to public school, and about 82% of First Nations, Métis, and Inuit kids go to provincially funded schools as well. So we've been working very hard in People for Education about how we deal with the fact that A, Annie Kidder's the problem, but also that B, we want our schools to change so that your children never feel the way that you've just described feeling. So what do we need to do in our schools differently?
For Indigenous children in the mainstream system?
In both ways. Yeah. For Indigenous children then.
Well, I think you can hit two birds with one stone by educating the non-Native people, actually. And I think part of that is there are a number of kind of founding myths that sort of need to be dispelled right away, like the two founding nations. Like, if we could get rid of that, that would be great. There are hundreds of founding nations. and also, I think I was thinking about reservations because I'm now living online again. And the boundaries of our territory is actually much larger than these little prisons that we were put into in the 1800s. And I think that process of segregation is so entrenched, even when we're sitting beside each other in a classroom. So there's something about the mentality that we've developed that's being passed down generationally that doesn't even allow us to communicate, even when we're trying to. We have an intense amount of mistrust of non-Native people, for good fucking reason. But you know, I remember going to high school, and that's when you first have to go off the reserve. So it's like you're on a boat for 20 minutes, then you're in a frickin' bus for 45 minutes while they drive you all the way to the school. That's the first issue. I'm really pissed off by the time I get there. And then you're walking through, and because of the way I was raised, I'm quite comfortable in non-Native society, right? Because I've been raised by it all, by both sides, and also I had black parents, I had it all. So I am a different kind of species. But most of the kids that I was going to school with, we walk around in a pack of protection, right? So even though we're in this non-Native school, we don't communicate, we don't trust. And same thing with the non-Native people. They have so many preconceptions about Indigenous people. And I think if they've got an education in treaties, like the treaty territory that they're on, the complicatedness of treaties, so we're talking about the spirit and intent of treaties, not the fucking written paper, that's a lie. We're talking about the ceremonialization of those treaties. So they are living spiritual documents that can be changed and rewritten now because they were signed under duress. So those kinds of things. And I think also they should know about the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples. They should know about UNDRIP. They should know about the TRC. So all of these kind of documents that we already have. We have the tools already.
Thank you very, very, very much. Okay. It's up to you guys. guys now. Please don't get up and make speeches. Please ask these incredibly smart experts questions. We are trying to get at, we are really truly using this information to advocate for changes. So come and ask them questions. They will answer them. Try not to make a speech. Line up. We've got about 15 more minutes left to do this. Sir.
Sego. Skanagoaga. My name is Peter Garrell. That's my English name. Galagugge is my Mohawk name. You take the two-row wampum belt. When I say Galagugge, I'm in the canoe on that two-row wampum belt. When I see Peter Garrell, I'm in the ship. I cross both. Remarkable panel. I'm really appreciative of what you've had to say. We have, in every event, gathering. We talk about the Thanksgiving address. A lot of times people consider it a prayer. All we're doing is giving thanks to the Creator for what He has given us. Maybe if you have an opportunity to get a copy, read it. It's been translated in probably 20 different languages across the world through our Mohawk Nation house. But one of the things that really captured me, because it talks about the environment, I had an opportunity to read Original Instructions, which is a compilation of the Bioneers Conference that's been going on for probably 18, 19 years now. And it's a remarkable thing when you look at what they're trying to do and correct what we've done to Mother Earth. Another opportunity, maybe I'm plugging this, but another opportunity, read Original Instructions. I think that honoring the treaties and what you said, I've been in both worlds continuously. Looking at your tree, Miss Minister, okay, is really remarkable because the Canadian Council on Learning also did a symbol of the tree on lifelong learning. And the Métis Nation have also did a lifelong learning. I think the Inuit did something of the blanket. Those are, again, examples of things. So I just wanted to say that it was really great to hear you. But what about Tsleil-Waututh? Where does that come to play right now? Last year, Tsleil-Waututh decision came about our traditional land and protecting it. We need to understand what that all means, and we need to challenge. We need to challenge Canada, but also we need to challenge the UN because we all have been faced with Tsleil-Waututh.
Okay, thank you very much, Peter. So maybe I think actually answering that in terms of and trying to think of it in terms of the frame of public education, and if you can in 30 seconds explain the Tsleil-Waututh finding, but also then what it means when we're thinking about how we talk and work with kids and young people. Go Wanda and maybe Faisal and or probably Carolyn. Quick. Don't be polite with each other, just answer.
I just wanted to say, I'll say this first and then I'll let him just do the decision and then I'll say something after he talks. But I just want to say is when I say treaty, I also mean wampum. I mean like the entire indigenous Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, like all of our ways of conceiving of those relationships. Treaty comes from us, comes from our culture. So, yeah, just wanted to put that out there.
Thank you. And Faisal, in terms of that, the question then about the Tsleil-Waututh that Peter said was an important part of what we should be thinking about and knowing.
Yeah, I mean, Tsleil-Waututh is an incredibly important Supreme Court decision that just furthers our re-emphasizing the fact that Indigenous people have been here for time immemorial, that this is their land, that in fact they are not going to be ruled by policies that are created without their interests in mind, without their participation. And what I find really interesting about Tsleil-Waututh, because I work very closely with the Tsleil-Waututh people, is that it completely resets the landscape, where the Tsleil-Waututh people now are talking about Tsleil-Waututh environmental laws, Tsleil-Waututh policies, would it be at water or forests or mining and such. And this is just one of hundreds of First Nations and other Indigenous peoples that are reaffirming their governance. And I think it's a very exciting time for the country.
So, Carolyn, there you are, the minister. And think of it in terms of both things, then, the TRC. And if we could try and think about the education piece, TRC, calls to action, lots of stuff about education, and that sense of truth and reconciliation. So what do you see needing to happen next?
Well, I think even in the interim report of the TRC, changing curricula was there. I mean, it was telegraphed 2.5 years ago, so everybody needs to get on with that. It's what I lovingly refer to as idle canomore, meaning the eradicating the ignorance of non-Indigenous people in Canada is got to be what reconciliation means. So the truth about residential schools was out, but the truth about our ignorance in how, as Annie said, what we learned in school is not really out. I mean, Justice Sinclair talks about the secret of shame, but it's much broader than just residential schools, as Wanda said. So if you think to New Zealand, which is 30, 40 years ahead of us on this, where language nests are part of preschool, where Maori studies is kindergarten to grade 8, where not just in social studies, but in all of the subjects, and it is about no Kiwi kid would sit on a desk or on a table because that's against Maori culture. That when you think of the haka ceremony with the football team or with the armed forces, that's the way they celebrate, not just at the Olympics. I think it's a matter of how you become comfortable such that at school kids want to learn. They're lucky enough to have an Indigenous kid in their class that they can find out. Because I have to say that this separation is really damaging. And I don't think you should have to be an MP to have the new friends that I do now that have changed my understanding of being Canadian. And so my friends over the last 4 years, and I had some before and patients and all kinds of things, but I would say that this last 4 years has been, and it's like any fight, right? The fight for Women's College Hospital, those are some of my best friends. That when you're in there, and so, you know, when the Rotary Club asked me to come and talk about Indigenous stuff, I talk about, usually I take Cynthia Wesley Escamar or somebody with me because I don't think I can do this on my own. But I can't talk about creating allies. And we can push Indigo chapters to have June as Indigenous Book Club Month. We can push the Canadian Libraries Association to do the same thing. We need to push the summer camps to get more authentic programming around the teachings on the land and in the water. So that the Boys and Girls Clubs, Girl Scouts, you know, Girl Guys, Boy Scouts, I don't care, but we've got to also have parents understanding that what their kids are learning in the curriculum in school is imperative, that they should be tested too, maybe. I don't know. I think, like, yeah, in the same way as you have to pass French to get your kid in some sort of French class, maybe we need. And I remember at U of T, when I graduated, you had to be able to swim a length of the pool. I don't think that it's too much to ask for every kid graduating from a university to at least have one course in Indigenous studies.
So I'm going to give Craig a chance also to... is that okay? Okay, go to the next question.
Thank you to a truly amazing panel. I wish to challenge our existing reality a wee bit with this question, and it might begin with Faisal. You spoke about cumulative impact on our land. Could you foresee a limit on the number of children that we're allowed to have here? It's a bit beyond our thinking, but in 30 to 40 years from now, could you foresee that happening with the cumulative impact on our land?
Good. I'll answer it because I was like, we're trying to like totally have so much sex with each other and so many children.
Thank you, Wanda.
So that we're more than 2% of the population.
Okay. You answered that question. First, tell us how many children you have, and
So, China had a one-child policy, and it's finally coming down. And one of the things that we know from the China experience is, man, this is a bad idea. right? Because if you start putting in limitations on the number of children people can have, you're going to start distortions in your society that you really do not want. And so I think that the Chinese experience with child limitations is definitely a false course. But what is true is that when we're thinking about perhaps putting in more balance, and I think that you know, you can have this discussion about economic development in a whole variety of different ways, right? One is, you know, the path we're on is completely unsustainable and we need to completely change everything we're doing and our entire way of living because, you know, it's not consistent with the environment. And that's one way of looking at this. Another way of looking at it is that from an economist's point of view, what I'd argue is that the value of natural capital is not getting adequately priced in economic models. And ultimately, if you don't have a price on something, right, you're then not going to end up with appropriate economic policy. And so one of the things I've worked on in the past was looking at the value of natural capital. And if we started properly valuing nature in the decisions that we're making on economic development, in actual fact, your economic models will actually generate quite sensible outcomes. Right? So I wouldn't actually say that the solution to the environmental problem is to restrict the number of kids we're having. In fact, I want more kids because I want larger population of workers so that we actually have more prosperity, which was part of the argument I was making before about you either grow because you have more kids or you use the people you have more productively. So I think that we don't want to restrict the kids, but we do need to have better and more sustainable economic outcomes for the people we have.
Thank you. Let me retable that question for 20 years and then re-ask
okay.
the same question.
Okay, we have two more questions. If you can ask them fairly quickly, because really this poor Marina, we are out of time. So done a great job, Marina.
On a really practical level, I think you guys are all advocating for really interesting things to bring into your classrooms. There's a lot of educators here. I'm wondering if there's something that sort of, in your mind, that can be a practical resource that you think maybe isn't accessed often enough in the classroom, say, you know, from the Suzuki Institute or Aboriginal issues. Like, you know, what's something people can bring in on a practical level and they can access?
Yeah, great basically. Question. A practical thing. Very short answer, please.
Take your kids outside.
Good.
It's really important.
Thank you. Carolyn, what's a practical thing in a classroom in terms of health?
Well, I think anything around the health literacy piece. So the Choose Wisely campaign, I mean, in terms of high school, how you evaluate scientific, I think there's all kinds of things that we need. I mean, our bodies ourselves changed everything, I think, in women's health. And so how do we do all of that? But I think we do have to start also on the indigenous side with whether it's Eighth Fire, the CDs from CBC, or whether it's Richard Wagamese or, you know, even other allies as writers, that there's got to be important things from Thomas King to, I just think that somehow people have to feel much more comfortable. And I think that the thing about Indigenous writers is that they have a sense of humor. And so it's easy, actually, to read Thomas King or the one Peace Pipe Dreams from he lives in L.A., you know, that says, every Indian gets a new truck. Why didn't I get a new truck? You know, sort of, I mean, it's a how you blow open the stereotypes and have people help you.
Wanda.
I think along with what Faisal was saying, too, is like I benefited from an exchange program between our reserve and a Toronto school, and they benefited by getting out on the land. So those kinds of developing sister schools between non-native schools and native schools would be awesome. And that breaks down a hell of a lot of barriers. Mm.
And teach your kids a love of reading, because reading will basically expose your kids to more ideas, and then you can have more constructive discussions about how to deal with issues like we have today.
Fabulous. Last question.
Uluku. My name is Rob Lackey. I'm Inuk. I was born in Happy Valley, Labrador. I've been working in another university at the north end of Toronto. I won't say which one, but you can figure it out. Just got back from our national gathering last night in Ottawa, the first one ever. So we're creating this network of Inuit across Canada. The biggest question that kept coming up was access to post-secondary education. the model that's in place now, and congratulations on your new post in the cabinet. The question was, how do we access Inuit-specific programming and education for post-secondary students? Currently, we have to use the model of First Nations. Inuit have to actually contact Mississauga's New Credit First Nation for funding, and we're totally separate people, so how do we access our own specific funding?
Okay, thank you very, very much. This is the last question, and we're so far. We're about
I think it's an excellent question, because I think that in some ways we've had a sort of First Nation sort of slant on things today, and everything about the Kelowna Accord was distinctions-based, so that you actually do have to have First Nations and you meet Métis. Nothing pan-Aboriginal will work, and that we do need to. And happy Inuit Day today, actually. But it's a, it is about how we create those modules across the distinctions, such that I think that teachers and programmers can pop them in, invite people, and I think we have to use much more technology to get elders and get all kinds of people just visiting and sharing stories is how we do this. But I mean, I think that it's quite clear that the North is going to need a university.
Okay, so that thank you so much to all the panelists. You guys have been just fantastic. Really, truly.